I am pleased to introduce Maurice Levin, who is seated on the around the center. She's a postdoctoral scholar at the Stanford Archaeology Center. Her research interests center on food production systems, historical ecology, and cultural niche construction in the Pacific Islands and in East Asia. She's a paleoethnobotanist who employs phytoliths, starch, and plant macrame analysis in her work, as well as ethnoarchaeology. She holds a BA in anthropology from Whitman College and an MA and PhD from the University of Oregon, where she studied managed agroforests in Pompeii, Micronesia, using landscape survey and ancient and modern botanical data. Her current work includes ongoing projects in Pompeii and Pangalap Islands in Micronesia, as well as collaborative work at Stanford on plant microremains from across the Eastern Hemisphere, especially Northeast China. And today she's drawing from her research to give us a talk on marginal landscapes and cultural niche construction, a view from the agroforest of Micronesia. Please join me in welcoming Maurice.
Jasmine. So what I'll be talking about today are the ways that humans help form landscapes in Central Eastern Micronesia. So specifically what I'll be looking at is two islands that I've worked on, Pohnpei and Pangalap. And I do want to note here that my work on Pangalap is still really in its early stages. The first excavations that we did on the island were last summer, and so I'm really looking forward to hearing any comments that you might have afterwards on this new area of work. So the Pacific Ocean covers one third of the Earth's surface, and it was one of the last major regions on Earth to be settled by humans. To us as continental dwellers, it often seems vast, remote, and forbidding. But to many indigenous Pacific Islanders, it seems really different than it seems to us. So I want to introduce this quote from Apele Haofa, who was a Fijian and Tongan anthropologist. And this comes from a really excellent essay that challenges colonial narratives about Oceania and the way that academic study can sometimes enforce these narratives. So he says, our ancestors, who had lived in the Pacific for over 2,000 years, viewed the world as a sea of islands rather than as islands in the sea. This may be seen in a common categorization of people, as exemplified in Tonga by the inhabitants of the main capital island, who used to refer to their compatriots from the rest of the archipelago, not so much as people from outer islands, as social scientists would say, but as the Kaimei Tahi, or just Tahi, people from the sea. This characterization reveals the underlying assumption that the sea is home to such people. So to Pacific Islanders, the world does not end at the edge of the land. The sea is very much part of the landscape they envision as part of their home. And so this may or may not be, this is, I do want to acknowledge this is the modern view, and this may or may not be equivalent to the way that the very first people to find and live on Pacific Islands thought about the world, but it's certainly very much characteristic of many current oceanic societies. Geologically, there are many types of islands in the Pacific, but two of the biggest categories are high islands and atolls. High islands are the result of volcanic eruption on the ocean floor, which eventually pierces the surface of the ocean and can form large volcanic islands. These can get to be pretty big. For example, the island of Hawaii is more than 10,000 square kilometers, which is about the size of Lebanon, and it has a high point of over 4,000 meters. The island of Pohnpei, which is pictured here and which I'll be talking about today, is quite a bit smaller, but it's one of the largest high islands in Micronesia at 310 kilometers squared. And this here is Sokhez Rock, which is one of the really scenic areas on Pohnpei. It's very iconic of the island. Atolls are really further along in the geological process of island formation. So in many tropical waters, coral reefs will revolve around the island, grow around the island. This takes thousands of years, and eventually it'll form a fringing reef. Over time, the volcanic island will continue to subside, and It will develop a barrier reef with many islets that encircle the volcano with a lagoon in between, and Pohnpei has such a reef. Eventually, the volcanic islets subside completely beneath the surface, and this creates an atoll. And here's an example. This is Mokuloa Atoll, which is between Pingalep and Pohnpei, and this is as seen from a tiny airplane all the way between the two islands. Atoll environments tend to have very low biodiversity, and they have few or no native terrestrial species, especially ones edible to humans. High susceptibility to adverse weather events because they're very low to the surface, and in many cases, they're extremely isolated. There's also a low accessibility to fresh water. So the way that people on atolls get fresh water is generally from the Gibbon-Herzberg lens, where rainfall is absorbed into the surface, and you end up with this freshwater lens that sits on top of the saltwater lens below, and then people also use a rainwater catchment. And from a Western perspective, this sounds like a pretty harsh way to live. And indeed, Western scholarship has long referred to atolls as marginal. However, people have lived on atolls in the Pacific for 2,000 years or longer. And paleoecological and archaeological data show that humans living on these islands have engaged in intense ecological engineering processes. And these made them more amenable to habitation, but not only by humans, but also by other species, because we see an increase in biodiversity. Much of this ecological engineering is related to preparation of the environment for food production, which is what I'm going to be talking about mostly today. So there are three major topics that I would like to explore today. And first one is just the simple question of what strategies have Micronesians used and continue to use to obtain food. And what I mean by this is what types of farming practices are they engaging in? What types of foraging practices? How intensively are they fishing? And then what material culture is affiliated with these production activities? What are the ways that Micronesians have engineered and continue to engineer their landscapes? So how have humans shaped the physical and chemical structure of islands to meet their needs? And then the last is that our current conceptions of the marginality of some Pacific islands accurate or useful when we're considering the deep past? So atolls were settled almost as soon as they were available when sea levels stabilized. So it's very unlikely that moving to atolls was a last resort for the people who settled there. Despite the fact that the word marginal is often used to describe atolls, it's really rarely defined in the archaeological literature. But the things that seem to characterize it are low arability. Now, this is usually defined as low arability of land. Ocean access isn't mentioned as often, and ocean access is really important because a lot of Pacific Islanders, especially people on atolls, get a lot of their food from the ocean, fish, shellfish, kelp, and such things. Low biodiversity is also seen to be a marker, as well as isolation. And the idea of atolls as marginal has recently begun to be challenged within Pacific Islands archaeology. So Marshall Weisler, who has done decades of research in the Marshall Islands, has shown this time and time again, and a lot of his recent writing talks about this, that atoll environments might not want to characterize them as marginal. So what I'm using here So humans have lived in both high island and atoll environments in the Pacific. And so ultimately today, what I want to consider is the way humans have engineered physical and social landscapes. And I'm using the lens of niche construction theory. And I want to use an explicitly ecological theory to understand humans as part of the environment, not just something that's acting on the environment, something that's interacting with the environment, but also as something that is actually a part of the environment. And so this falls under the broad framework of historical ecology. Basically, in niche construction, organisms modify selection pressures into their environment to the extent that we must consider ecological inheritance as an independent factor in evolution. So that means that organisms modify their environment and that the next generation inherits not only the genetic changes, but also the environmental changes. And one of the ways that this is accomplished is through a process called ecological engineering. Probably the most commonly cited example of this is beavers building dams. But of course, humans engage in this process as well. Primarily what I'll be focusing on today is cultural niche construction theory. So I'm not necessarily looking at large-scale biological evolution. Well, I am looking at ultimately large-scale evolutionary practices, but the idea in cultural niche construction is that genes affect culture, which affect environment, which affect genes, and so culture is part of this environmental modification feedback, and it's really an integral part of it. Niche construction theory has been increasingly applied to understanding agriculture, as agriculture involved environmental engineering by both humans and plants, and the resulting environments are crucial to the functioning of human cultures. So ultimately, what I'm interested in here is the relationship between the production of food and the physical and social environment in the past. So this project focuses in on an area of the remote Pacific Ocean, Central Eastern Micronesia, as a view into these processes. The Pacific Islands are a center for plant domestication. Plants were domesticated, such as taro and bananas, in New Guinea by at least 6,500 years ago. And there's a very long history of environmental modification on New Guinea. And the domestication of these crops really helped facilitate the eventual settlement of the remote Pacific by people who transported these cultivated plants to new environments in a process that is often referred to as transporting landscapes. Arboricultural systems in much of the Pacific, however, because these are not systems that rely on grain production, but they rely on roots and on tree plants, can be a little difficult to recognize archaeologically, although by using things such as plant micro remains and other types of microscopic evidence, it can be more recognizable. One other aspect of this that I think is important is that arboricultural systems necessarily require long-term planning. Kyle Latinas has a great paper about this that is now about 18 years old, but it discusses how when you're planning an agricultural system that's based on tree crops, you're not planning for the next year. You plant a tree, it's not going to produce fruit in the next year. It might take 3 years, it might take 5 years. So you're really planning for far out in the future, maybe even the next generation. So you might be planting a tree that's ultimately not going to be feeding you, but will be feeding your children. Archaeologists and anthropologists often talk about the Pacific in terms of three culture areas: Micronesia, Polynesia, and Melanesia. These are somewhat problematic terms as they're old colonial terms, and in terms of linguistics and modern culture, the terms Micronesia and Melanesia don't actually really mean a lot, although Polynesia, which is settled much more recently, shares much more internally, linguistically, and culturally. But the main reason why we still use these terms is they're a convenient geographical shorthand. What is more useful to understand culturally and linguistically is the concepts of near Oceania and remote Oceania. So near Oceania is this area over here, and this was settled by humans 40, 50,000 years ago, and people first settled these larger areas, but it's clear that even during the Pleistocene, they were traveling out to islands that were further and further. And then populations that spoke Austronesian languages, which and Austronesian languages originated in Taiwan, migrated through the area and eventually migrated out and were the first to settle in remote Oceania using some of the plants that were developed in this region. In eastern Micronesia, there's not that many high islands, but there are a few. The main ones are Chuuk, Pohnpei, and Kosrae. And Chuuk is really an almost atoll. It has a bunch of little high islands. And the earliest archaeological dates for this region are about 2,000 years ago. It was likely settled from the southeast Solomons or Vanuatu. And some people have suggested that it was settled by engagement in island seeding. So basically where people would travel to the island, spend a little bit of time on them, plant new plants, move away a little bit, then they'd come back. Things would have grown a little more, been a little more suited to what they want in terms of settlement. And we've got Pohnpei here, which is the high island that I work on, and Kingalap is a coral atoll, and these two are about 280 kilometers apart. They have similar climates, but they're really different geologically. Pohnpei is a high island with a barrier reef, and Kingalap is an atoll. They do have similarities in construction of social hierarchies. They both, in current times, use the Nanwarki system, which is a system of kingship, and oral histories suggest that the two of these islands are often in contact, and this is pretty typical of atolls. So people on atolls tended to travel a lot and not necessarily be confined to their atolls, but they would interact with people in many different places and spend a lot of time traveling. Pohnpei is a high island, and it's located at about 6 degrees north. Much of the island consists of high ridges and peaks, and the highest of this is about 790 meters above sea level. And precipitation is really high year-round. There's about 4,700 millimeters of precipitation in the inhabited areas, which tend to be along the coastline. The average mean temperature is about 29 degrees Celsius year-round, so it's a very hot and humid environment. And my work is on this little island just off the coast. It's very much integrated into Pohnpei, and in fact has been central to social systems in the past and in the present. So Bill Ayers and his colleagues have done extensive survey work at Awak and Wenning on the main island of Pohnpei. And they've collected a lot of data related to agriculture, which includes terraces, pits, cookhouses, and similar sites. And based on these data, the timeline of subsistence shows that managed forests really appeared early in the sequence, early in the first millennium AD. We start to see permanent plots. And it supports the idea that there's an increasingly a prestige-based system. There's also been a significant amount of ethnographic and ethnobotanical work. For example, William Bascom's Prestige Economy discusses the idea that there is the subsistence level economy where people are growing plants to primarily eat, and then the prestige economy where people are growing plants for the purposes of feasting and bringing them to prestige events. And my previously collected data shows that these two models of economy were both present in the second millennium AD. So, like most Pacific islands, managed forests and gardens are really important. Here, some of the plants are breadfruit, which is the big starchy fruit. And we've got yams here. In the US, when a lot of people think of yams, they think of sweet potatoes, but these are gigantic Pacific yams, which is a different species, and these can grow to upwards of 100 kilograms, so pretty incredible. And these are used often in feasting. So bananas are also an important staple crop, as well as pandanus, coconut, and taro, as well as kava, which is called cacao locally. So Chemlin Island, which is where my research site is located, is on the southeast coast. It's separated from the main island by a really narrow strait that's connected by a causeway today, so you can drive right onto the island. It's about 2.5 square kilometers, and the Nan Madol complex is located right off the coast of Chemlin Island. This consists of approximately 100 artificial islets, and they were constructed between 1500 to 500 BP. These are associated with the island's elites and their retainers. The earliest data from this area dates to about 2000 BP, and these are the earliest dates on Pohnpei. They're associated with early pottery, which disappeared early in the sequence, and they're from pre-islet surfaces at the Nan Madol site. So Nan Madol is really this dramatic example of ecological engineering on Pohnpei. So we have these columnar basalt and tremendous amounts of coral rubble that were transported to the site. And there's been some people doing some really interesting work on transportation of basalt and seeing what quarries that originated from. So this would all have to be carried to the site. This is one islet. This is Nam Doas, which is the largest islet. But there are about 100 of these. And there's this really dramatic example of building these islets off of the coast. But there are also some more subtle forms of ecological engineering, like working with the soils. And so I put a test pit in a garden area. It was designed to test for change over time. So it's a pretty simple stratigraphy. And there are two single dates here. We have 1730 to 680 Calamity, and then a much more recent date at the top. And so we have a garden setting here spanning about 7,000 years. Sorry, 700 years. So phytolith analysis from this site provides details about the surrounding environment through time in this garden area. So the most notable pattern is this dramatic spike in grasses in the upper half of the unit, especially in the top layer. And there's also a number of banana phytoliths that appear in the upper half of the unit. Microcharcoal is more prominent in the lower level. However, microcharcoal can be either local or regional, and so this suggests that there's some burning incidents. So to look at these patterns, we also looked at the macrocharcoal. And so overall, the patterns in macrocharcoal roughly match those in the microcharcoal and phytolith assemblages. Higher charcoal concentrations are seen in the lowest level with macrocharcoal, and this shows burning activities in the area prior to this 730 to 680 Cal BP time. And charcoal concentrations fluctuate with the middle of the deposits, and it also corresponds with increases in grass phytoliths. So we can conclude that the microcharcoal observed is likely the result of repeated local fires. So people are engaging in swindening practices to manage the landscape. Because of the higher levels of rainfall, non-anthropogenic fires are extremely unlikely. Given the oral traditions and the ethnographic evidence for periodic swindening, this clearly represents an anthropogenic burning regime associated with agricultural practices. Looking at it on a spatial level, we see really heavy use of the landscape for gardening over time. So here, there's a whole bunch of different cultural features that we located on the landscape. Yam enclosures were the most common. We've also got breadfruit fermentation pits, as well as other cultural features. And so if we look at the yam pits, the yam cultivation pits and the breadfruit pits separately, there are some patterns that emerge. The yam enclosures do cluster together, which may be related to soil quality. It's hard to say if this is related to people improving soils in these particular areas or if people were specifically choosing areas that already had higher soil quality. And then breadfruit fermentation pits also occur across the landscape. And breadfruit fermentation pits are generally associated with the prestige economy as well as preservation of breadfruit for times when it's not in season. So Temwin and Pohnpei in general can be seen as this anthropologically engineered landscape. We have human habitation from about 2,000 years ago, and human introduced plants and animals from this time. And if you look at this photo here of this, so we have this the remains of this household structure that was related to, that was dated to about 800 years ago. But if you look in the background here, you can see a whole bunch of plants that would have been introduced to the environment. A lot of the so we've got on the island breadfruit, coconut, banana. So most of these plants were likely introduced by human settlement. Moving on to Pingalap Atoll. So this is a brand new project. I've made two trips to Pingalap now. Two summers ago I went just to initiate a project and do some reconnaissance survey, and then last summer we went back and did some excavation. And Pohnpei and Pingalap are relatively close to each other, about 280 kilometers apart, and they share many cultural similarities, but they have these really different environments. So one of the things I want to look at is how have Pohnpeians and Pingalaps built their environments differently. And Pingalapis, they tend to, it isn't a matter of it being a less enjoyable place. There have been accounts of Pingalapis moving to Pohnpei and the environment just really doesn't work well for them because it's totally new and they're not used to all of these hills and they're not used to the volcanic soils. So some of you might be familiar with the island of Pingalap because of Oliver Sacks's 1997 book that was named for the island. Pingalap is best known in the West for the high rate of complete achromatopsia, or total colorblindness. About 5 to 10% of the population can't see any color. This rate is about 1 out of 30,000 in most of the world. This is due to a recessive mutation, and it's thought to have been prevalent after an 18th century storm killed almost everyone except for 20 people, resulting in this genetic bottleneck. And this exemplifies one of the things that can be hard about living on atolls, is it's really hard to escape storms. There's just not a lot of places to go. You go to the highest point on the island, but if the highest point on the island is 4 or 5 meters, you're not getting a ton of protection. So to understand cultural niche construction on Pingalap, I'm using several lines of evidence, and I'm really in the process of doing some of this analysis versus the on-the-ground archaeology. I'm also looking at archaeobotanical evidence, so plant remains, as well as zooarchaeology. So there's a tremendous amount of bones that have been preserved in the sites that we are looking at as well as ethnoarchaeology. So I want to talking to modern Pingalapese people and learning how they conceptualize their own landscape. So atolls in this region emerged about 3,000 to 4,000 years ago. And after about 1,000 years of that, they became large enough for permanent residence. And evidence for habitation occurs on many atolls for soon after this. And Pingalap is not an exception here. Nearby Mokoloa Atoll, some colleagues have been working there, and there's a continuous presence from about 1700 to 1560 Cal BP. And this is really similar to the brand new dates from Pingalap. So we started out this summer by putting a test pit in one of the highest parts of the island, because people build up atolls. Through farming processes, they continue to add land and throw things away and add land. So you end up with these high areas of the island that have this tremendous cultural stratigraphy. So we ascended to the high point, climbed the 5 meters up to the high point, and put in a test unit. And this ended up being tremendously rich archaeologically. So this is the stratigraphic profile, and I will say at the bottom here, I wouldn't call this sterile. It was more that we hit a gigantic piece of coral, and it was impossible to go on, and we were also starting to get concerned about the safety of a one-by-one that was 3 meters deep. But we still got a ton of information from this, and so the dates, and I'm planning more radiocarbon dates from here, but we have the earliest date is 1630 to 1520 Cal BP, and then we have the latest date at about 70 centimeters from 1355 to 1280 Cal BP. So most of this deposit, at least where these dates are, is over the course of a few hundred years. We also have below that, however, there wasn't a lot of great material to work. Right now I'm working through the material and trying to figure out materials that are suitable for dating from this bottom area, but we found a few artifacts from here, like this shell adze that was in the 270 to 280 centimeter level. There were also a bunch of historic artifacts up here, which could be really interesting from a historical perspective. Most of them look like we're from the mid-20th century. And we know that there's you know, at least a few decades of age in them, because we did find one dog tooth, and dogs were actually banned from the island in 1982 because they were causing some issues with destroying the environment, making a lot of mess. So the artifacts we recovered, these are all from the bottom 100 centimeters, the bottom meter of that test unit. But we have this shell adze, so that's from likely before that 1630 Cal BP date, and then we also have a few beads and this pendant type shell item. So people on modern Pingalap make and catch most of their own food. This is an example of the lunch that I was generously given at a picnic on one of my last days on Pingalap. And this is pretty typical Pingalapese fare. We've got boiled bananas and reef fish. Those would have been things that people grew by themselves. They would have been grown on the island. And then we also have rice. People these days import a lot of rice, and rice is really beloved in Micronesia post-World War II. And so I conducted an ethnographic survey to better understand modern farming practices and how people engage with their landscape. And so what my goals are with this were to both help with archaeological interpretation in the ways that it's not going to be a one-to-one correlation, but I figure it opens up new avenues to explore and open new possibilities, things I might not have considered. And also to better understand how my research can interface with the Pingalapese community and their needs. So it was just a pretty small survey. There were 14 participants. Most of them were men, and I'm not going to pretend this is a This is a very, I'm not gonna pretend that this is representative. This was mostly about putting the word out there and saying, hey, who wants to talk to me about farming? But it's a, so it's very much exploratory data. And we have a wide range of ages, people ages 29 to 81. And a little more than half of them identified themselves as having lived on Pinulap their whole life. There were people who had lived off island, had lived in places such as Pohnpei, Guam, Hawaii, so mostly, mostly in the Pacific. So when I asked the type of question, what types of foods do you grow? 100% answered with banana and breadfruit. Some of these, so these were the most commonly farmed plants in my survey. Pandanus and giant swamp taro were also very commonly grown. And giant swamp taro is grown in this patch in the center of the island, in the center of the main island. Sweet taro, which is Colocasia esculenta, and it's most often, it's what's most often thought of as taro in Polynesia, was farmed by some. But it was generally not a preferred food in the same way that giant swamp taro is. And yams, which I showed you earlier, which are hugely important on Pohnpei, were farmed by almost half of my respondents. I don't have any data from Pohnpei, unfortunately, but my impression is that just from talking to Pohnpei people and spending time there, that it would be close to 100% there. The only historically introduced plant that was grown by more than one interviewee was papaya, which is the domesticated of the Americas. So about half of their, a little under half the people reported that they grew papaya. So even today in traditional farming practices, people tend to stick to a few traditional staples. And in terms of maintaining their gardens, there was a pretty wide variation. Some from constant checking to some said, well, I just plant and leave it there for a year and see what happens. And the most commonly mentioned fertilizer was dead leaves, and this includes leaves from breadfruit, banana, taro, a plant called moss, and also from grass. And many people were also quite specific about the types of plants that they used for the fertilizer. Other parts of plants were also mentioned, such as banana stem and coconut skin, and adding topsoil, of course, was also part of it. And most plants that people mentioned do not need constant maintenance, so a lot of it was really just starting it up was the hard part. They'd leave it there and check on it occasionally. And I think understanding this maintenance can be really important in ecological engineering. So how are people improving the soil? Because this is one of the reasons why there is good farming soil on atolls, is because people have worked really hard over hundreds of years to make this into good farming soil. This is also a benefit of this is that many leaves produce a lot of phytoliths, and so this will be really when I proceed to the phytolith analysis, this will be really interesting information to have, because I can look at the types of phytoliths that show up and compare it against this list that I got. And it's also really useful to just think about the fact that the plants that you're getting in the soil are not just the plants that people are growing, but it's also the plants that people are using as fertilizer. So the next steps in analysis are plant macro remains and micro remains. Some of the plants that have already been identified are pandanus and palm. In the macro remains, as well as zooarchaeology, there was a tremendous amount of fish bone found at the site, as well as shellfish. We found some birds, some turtle. There were a few mammal bones, and there are also a lot of land snails, which can be really useful to look at environmental change. So humans have really impacted land snail populations in much of the Pacific. And those land snails are really sensitive to environmental changes. So I want to come back to this question. Is it appropriate to conceptualize the environment of Pingalap as more marginal than that of Pohnpei? And we have with Pingalap, we see this fairly early settlement that's not too long after Pohnpei was settled. And we see the extensive use of marine resources, even though we have really only begun the analysis of the zooarchaeological material. There's just this tremendous amount of marine resources. And ecological engineering by humans allowed agricultural plants to do really well. So a lot of plants do well on the island now. People raised the elevation of the island by at least 3 meters. So we put in a test unit, that 1 3-meter test unit. We put in also a few test units, one that was on the eastern side of the taro patch, and we hit sterile soil at about 40 centimeters there, and then one that we put in another low area of the island, we hit sterile at about 30 centimeters. So people really, really built up these high sections. And so I would argue that it's difficult to characterize these as this is a marginal environment, because people clearly wanted to live here, and I don't necessarily think that that's a useful way to conceptualize it. And the impacts of colonialism, modern day conceptualizations of the Pacific, and the demands of the market economy were not present in this region until the 1800s. And so nowadays, there are a lot of people that want to leave the island, and that for economic reasons do leave, and it has become, and people have stopped engaging in a lot of the traditional practices they engaged in. So in some ways, modern atolls can seem pretty marginal, but I think that it's, when we take away that modern layer, it gets to be a lot more difficult. I want to come back to Haofa's essay here. The world of Oceania is neither tiny nor deficient in resources. It was so only as a condition of the colonial confinement that lasted less than a century in history of millennia. Islanders have broken out of their confinement and are moving around and away from their homelands. Not so much because their countries are poor, but because they were unnaturally confined and severed from many of their traditional sources of wealth, and because it is in their blood to be mobile. And so, I think if we really want to understand how and why people settled and thrived in the Pacific for millennia, we need to recognize and rethink the boundaries that the Euro-American mindset of these as marginal landscapes has placed upon us. So lastly, I would like to address how this impacts the modern Pacific. So today's dramatic climate change is a problem to which Oceania has negligibly contributed, but is disproportionately impacted. But it's important to remember that the people of the Pacific are not passively accepting the rise in oceans and increased storm activities. While the impacts of anthropogenic climate change are a modern problem, the traditional ecological knowledge that islanders have used to construct their environments may help to develop innovative solutions. Because Pacific Island communities really know their environment better than any outsider can. And so many, many people have helped with logistical aspects of this project, and I would like to thank them all here. And I would like to thank all of you.
Of lots of time for questions.
Oh, okay, great. Thanks so much, Reese. I really, really enjoyed that, and it's great to see the work. I mean, the notion that people are effectively making land, right, is really, really exciting, in part because I think we tend to think about the political economy of land as something that people fight over, right? That land exists, and then people fight over land and resources, right? And your position is effectively that resources are created, right? Which is great. And so I have a question about that. And that is, where does the topsoil come from to actually generate the height and to generate the land, as it were? Because I was trying to think through, like, are they, you know, can you go to the beach and get sand and pile that up, but then maybe you deal with issues of salt and salt water, and maybe that's not so good for the crops. So I was wondering about where the land actually comes from, as it were, because presumably if it's not, if it's coming somewhere on the island, then it's actually lowering the elevation somewhere else, right?
Right.
So that was one question. But then the other thing I was thinking about was related to this notion of engineering and the ways in which you talk about biodiversity increasing when all the cultigens show up with people. And I was just kind of wondering, in your data, though, what is the longer term ecology of these environments? Like, how does the vegetation change? Like, do you have pollen? Do you have a sequence that can actually document what the ecology looks like pre-occupation, post? And do you see things like extinctions and things like that, such that, you know, you can talk about more biodiversity now and crops that people actually value, but there are probably some things that maybe don't exist anymore on the island. And so, yeah, I was wondering if you could speak to that.
Yeah, so to answer your first question, that is something that I think that's something I'd like to look at a little bit more. My impression is that people, you know, get their soil from various places wherever they can, but how that process started when people initially settled the island, I'm not 100% sure, but people, I think that it's pretty evident that people have kind of changed the edges and changed the shorelines to some extent. So to address your second question, so I don't, for my sites, unfortunately, I don't have this data yet. That's one of the things that I'm planning to do, is trying to get some of that pre-settlement data and looking at that, comparing it with the post-settlement data. There's a few pollen cores from Pohnpei that other people have done, but that hasn't really been the question that they're addressing, is how biodiversity changes. But I think that would be really interesting to look at. There are certainly a lot of data from other islands in the region, for example, with land snails. I know that land snail populations have decreased in some places from people using the landscape because it's destroyed their original environment, and there's also land snails that people have introduced. So there's certainly people bringing in things, and there are certainly things that are likely disappearing as well. But there's evidence for that happening across the Pacific, and that's certainly something I'd like to explore more in my own settings.
Yeah, that would be great. I mean, because I feel like there may be an intervention there too, because there's, of course, this notion, right, that islands, there's a big literature on how islands are so fragile, right, that, like, island ecosystems are not very robust, and so, and then there's, of course, a lot of literature on extinctions that come along with human occupation of islands, right, so it just seems like if you had data on that, there's a much more, I feel like there's a larger intervention that could be made,
yeah,
in terms of not just thinking about marginality, but even all the tropes around the sort of sustainability and the fragility of island ecosystems. Yeah, anyway,
yeah.
So thank you.
I'd be interested to know how some of the population are combating climate change. You mentioned that.
Yeah. So they're pretty small. The modern population of Pengalap is about 170 people that live there full time, although there have been more in the past. I know in the mid-20th century, some of the residents were telling me that there were, you know, 500 to 700 people who lived there full time. So I think a lot of that is related not to what the island can support agriculturally, but more to other economic opportunities and educational opportunities, and those kinds of things. But I know there's a Pacific Islanders have been pretty involved, like in the Paris climate talks. They were some of the people pushing for the strictest regulations, the strictest caps on emissions. You know, there's discussion of what things can be built to, in order to, islands above sea level and away from storms. But it's kind of one of those things where there's a whole bunch of things going on across the Pacific on that front.
But they need outside intervention, or are they able to?
There have been, so in a lot of cases there have been outside interventions, and there are some that are in a much more serious situation. Like, the islands I'm looking at are not particularly in a lot of trouble of disappearing, but in the nation of Kiribati, for example, which is to the east, there's been talk that Kiribati might actually disappear in the next century, and it's creating a situation where we have what are actually called climate refugees, where people's land is literally disappearing. And I know that there's been a whole bunch of discussion around that. There was a really cool thing in the New York Times last week that was talking about like these floating islands that I guess a Japanese firm is working on. And so there's, I mean, I know that there are people from outside working on it too.
I'm assuming that probably atolls like Pinalat were not capable of producing wood for watercraft in the past, and that there would have, for communication prior to modern navigation and aircraft, would have relied on wood from the higher islands. Is there any tradition on the atolls, such as this one, about who did the navigation? Were the atolls involved in navigation? And was there any sense of how they obtained wood for watercraft?
So surprisingly, atolls can support a lot of wood plants. Breadfruit is a really sturdy wood, and there are some varieties of breadfruit that grow pretty well in Pinalat, and it's what people who do traditional canoe activities still use now to make a lot of their canoes. So atolls have really been, in many ways, at the forefront of navigation, and a lot of high islanders tended to be the ones who historically have stayed on the island rather than traveling out, and then the atoll people would come to them.
So two questions. One is, you showed evidence of archaeological burning right in your text bits. Is that something that people are doing today? And do you have future plans for doing ethnography and pumping to be able to do that?
So there is definitely ethnohistorical data for people doing swimming activities. I have not personally seen anybody engaging in swimming or talking about doing it in modern times, but that's not to say it doesn't happen. So that's something I just am not 100% sure on. In terms of ethnography, I would very much like to conduct a similar study continuing with my work on Pinalat, obviously, and also developing a similar project on Phuong Pei to understand how Phuong Peians how Phuong Peians grow food and live within their environment.
Do the Micronesian elders recognize and understand the atolls versus the high volcanic islands in terms of the long-term resources, and is that evident in their settlement patterns?
Do they recognize that there's different? Oh yeah, for sure. So people who the elders tend to be very aware of what's available on their island and aware of what's on other islands.
Thank you very much. That was really interesting. It made me think a bit more about niche construction theory. You quoted a niche construction theorist saying that ecological transmission was an independent form of transmission, I presume, separate from genetic or cultural transmission. And I mean, your example just makes me sort of think how does one argue that ecological inheritance in this case is independent? It just seems that your work disproves that claim in the sense that the ecology is only continued and reproduced and handed down as part of very complex networks, not only of actually managing a land, but also climate change, but also of people leaving. You mean, you could think of this picture of people moving and leaving the islands and so on. So it's a very complicated picture that must have, so there must be all sorts of interactions that either mean that environment does get continued or doesn't. And so I just wondered if you comment on that, whether that idea of ecological transmission being independent is viable.
So I think that primarily with ecological transmission being separate from genetic transmission, it's something that is being passed on to the next generation in a way that the next generation inherits it, and they use that environment regardless of whatever genes they got from the previous generation. At least that's the way I read them as being separate. Now, of course, there are all kinds of different connections between people, but that transmission route itself, I see them as being somewhat separate routes. So you have the genetic inheritance, and I think the it's harder to disentangle certainly the cultural inheritance from the ecological inheritance, and I think in many ways those are one and the same. But I think genetic inheritance is because that occurs very separately from what's happening in the environment. But it's a separate thing, and these are both impacting the next generation.
Yes, thank you. I was wondering about the mobility patterns and how they might have changed. You talked about how it's been more depopulated these islands now, and how people are, I guess they go to university and other places outside.
Yeah.
But how has that changed from, because you were talking about climate refugees, but the people here, as you said, are extremely mobile and have always been extremely mobile, but also within, like this island, this landscape of islands,
yeah.
Like how would they, if one island, say, disappeared, would they move to an island close by, or how are the sort of cultural rules of moving between islands last 100 or 200 years?
I mean, people do move between islands, especially in the past 100 or 200 years. A lot of people have moved back and forth between many of the atolls and Pohnpei, especially since a lot of the economic opportunities and the educational opportunities are on Pohnpei. Like, there is a college on Pohnpei, and there's a lot of people go there just to go to high school because they just have the elementary and middle school on the atoll on Pingalap. And there is a certain amount of mobility, and Pohnpei seems to be very open to that, but there are also tend to be separate areas that people live in. So you'll end up with, like say all the Pingalapis on Pohnpei live in two separate areas where they're kind of clustered together, and the Mopiolis live in the separate area. So there has been on Pohnpei certainly an acceptance of people coming from the atolls, but people are also not as integrated into, because there is very much, people are integrated into the systems on their individual atoll and their individual island, and so it's a little harder to come in as an outsider to that environment and actually settle down to live there rather than to visit.
Hmm. So if they form, just a follow-up question, if they form sort of enclaves, or if they're yeah, there are some sort of separations in society. Would that affect like also food production, or is it mostly the same on the different islands of this region?
Yeah, so it could certainly affect food production. A lot of the foods grow really differently. Plants grow really differently on Pohnpei and Pingalap. Like yams are really important on Pohnpei. They don't grow as well on Pingalap. People don't grow them as much. You know, the soils are really, really different because you've got these alkaline coralline soils on atolls, and you have these really acidic volcanic soils on high islands. And so it's really quite a different environment, and so the agriculture does have to adjust.
Well, unfortunately, we're out of time, but please join me in thanking Dr. Ruffin.